Good afternoon all.
Hello.
Today we are going to present a case of chronic kidney disease for cholecystectomy. About the patient,
lab cholecystectomy or just cholecystectomy?
Lab cholecystectomy.
Yeah,
lab
you can be very clear. There, yes. Okay. Right.
About the patient detail. He is a 30-year-old male from Calicut who is a manual laborer presented with recurrent episodes of fever, vomiting, abdominal pain since 6 months. About the history of present illness, the patient presented with recurrent episodes of fever, which is low-grade in nature, intermittent in nature, with no diurnal variation. Vomiting, which is non-projected, usually occurs after taking food, especially fatty meals, which is non-bilious in nature, but not blood-stained. It's associated with abdominal pain. It is mainly in the upper abdomen, which is colicky in nature, aggravated after intake of food and relieved spontaneously. During this 6 month period, symptoms were managed conservatively. He also diagnosed to have chronic kidney disease on evaluation for frothy urine, swelling of hands and feet, and decreased micturition 2 years back. And he was on oral medication for that. But 6 months back, he started hemodialysis. Initially, it was through right internal jugular vein. Now it is, and once a week. Now it is doing 3 times in a week through an AV fistula in the left forearm. There is no history of decreased BP, breathing difficulty, itching, or any other allergic manifestations, muscle cramps during the dialysis. And the last dialysis was done yesterday, and now he is clinically better. There is no history of hematemesis or melena. There is no history of generalized pleuritis or easy bruisability. No recurrent respiratory tract infection, no dyspnea or chest pain, palpitation or syncope, no history of muscle cramps, numbness or tingling sensation, no history of seizures, memory loss or altered sensorium. About the drug history, he is taking telmisartan 40 mg OD, tapclonidine 100 microgram BD, tap sodium bicarbonate 100 mg OD, tap calcitriol 0.25 microgram OD, injection erythropoietin 4000 unit weekly thrice. About the past history, he is diagnosed to have glomerulonephritis at the age of 11. That time he had fever, generalized edema and urine discoloration. That time he was treated conservatively, but after that he was not on any further follow-up. There is no history of any diabetes, coronary artery disease, or any other significant illness in the past. There is no history of chronic analgesic intake or previous surgeries in the past. About the family history, nothing significant in the family. About the personal history, he is taking mixed diet, but appetite is decreased. Sleep is normal. Bowel habits are regular, but urine output is decreased. Now it is about 250 to 300 ml. It has no addictions. About the general examination.
Coming to the general examination, the patient is conscious, cooperative, oriented, pallor is present, bilateral pedal edema is present, no icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, or lymphadenopathy, and AV fistula is present on the left forearm. The patient's height is 167 cm, weight is 47 kg, and a BMI of 17.2. Coming to the airway examination, there is no apparent facial anomalies. Facial puffiness is present. The mouth opening is 4 cm, malampati class 2. Thyroventral distance is about 7 cm. TMJ is mobile and insinuation is possible with one finger. Neck movements are normal. Coming to the vital signs, pulse 96 per minute, regular rhythm, normal in volume and character. Peripheral pulses felt normal. Condition of vessel walls normal. AV fistula is present in the left forearm with thrill present. Blood pressure is 140 over 96 millimeter mercury in the sitting position and 130 over 70 millimeter mercury in the standing position. The respiratory rate is 15 per minute. It is regular and abnormal thoracic. Temperature is 37.2 degrees Celsius and the room air saturation is 99%. Coming to the abdominal examination, there is tenderness in the right hypochondrium on deep palpation. There is no abdominal distension, no guarding or rigidity. No organomegaly, hernial orifices are normal and the normal bowel sounds. Coming to the cardiovascular system, DVP is not elevated. There is a scar mark of the old IJV catheter on the right side of the neck. Apex beat is in the fifth left intercostal space in the midclavicular line. S1, S2 is normal and there is no murmur. And other systems are within normal limits. summarizing, there is a 30-year-old manual laborer with a history of chronic kidney disease, stage 5 on hemodialysis, now presented with recurrent episodes of fever, vomiting, and abdominal pain. On examination, the patient is conscious-oriented and vitals are already mentioned with pallor and bilateral pedal edema. Parabdomen examination reveals tenderness in the right hypochondrium and is diagnosed to have calculus cholecystitis and is now planned for cholecystectomy. Diagnosis, chronic kidney disease, stage 5 on hemodialysis, posted for laparoscopic cholecystectomy.
Okay. So you have completed presenting the case, this particular thing, and you have taken a very good history and examination also. You have done well. So can we go for the first slide, what you have in the presentation regarding the history? In the history of presenting illness. Next slide. Yeah, you have Ashita, you have said that here the patient has got chronic kidney disease. Can you just define what you mean by chronic kidney disease?
Chronic kidney disease means kidney damage more than or equal to 3 months as defined by structural or functional abnormalities of the kidney with or without decrease in GFR, manifested by either pathological abnormalities or markers of the kidney damage in blood, urine, and imaging studies, or GFR less than 60 ml per minute per 1.73 meter square more than or equal to 3 months with or without kidney damage.
Okay, so that means this patient was diagnosed to have kidney disease, chronic kidney disease, about 2 years back, isn't it? So can you go for the next slide? So now you have written that he has had a AV fistula. Under what anesthesia this patient had AV fistula?
The local anesthesia, that AV fistula is good, sir.
So because for us, more important is under what anesthesia, isn't it? Whether it is local or whether it is brachial block, both can be given, isn't it? Even brachial block also can be given. But what is more important is any untoward incident during the anesthesia. What can happen if even if it is being done under local anesthesia? Any problems can occur?
Because sometimes the patient may have severe pain during the procedure. So there will be increased sympathetic response.
I was trying to ask you about, allergic manifestations due to local anesthetics. Okay. So why allergic manifestations can occur due to the local anesthetic infiltration? Anything in the local anesthetics which can produce allergic manifestation?
Methyl paraben.
Yeah, very good. Why methyl paraben or propyl paraben can produce allergic manifestations? What is the metabolite of methyl and propyl paraben? It is a para-ammonobenzoic acid. It is a PABA that is very, very allergenic. So it can produce hypersensitive reaction. So this is one thing that you should always mention there. Whatever the surgery, even if it is a minor surgery, you have to write down uneventful or whether the event had occurred. Okay, next you have written here is last dialysis was done yesterday. So why it's important again?
Because the dry weight of the patient is significant when we consider dialysis. When we are taking the patient to surgery, usually 24 hours prior to surgery, we are doing the hemodialysis. Because during dialysis, there is a volume shift occurs. So we have to assess how much volume is removed and what is the weight loss after dialysis. That is the significance of timing of dialysis before surgery.
So what is the ideal time for you to take up the patient after dialysis?
24 hours. Ideally
24 hours or just after 6 hours? Suppose what happens if you take him after 24 hours? What do you expect the patient to have?
Sometimes some volume overload.
Volume overload will be there. How do you know volume overload is there in this particular patient? Now he was dialyzed previous day, and you should always write down the time, what time the dialysis was completed. So that is again very important for us to exactly know how many hours, isn't it? So why 6 hours always is said, and then within 24 hours, 6 hours ideally. Why? What are the reasons?
Because
if they are using heparin for dialysis, usually the we have to start the surgery only after twice the half life of the heparin. So ideally, six hours is a safe time. And
nowadays they do heparin free dialysis when they are taking these patients. Okay, that is fine. Any particular reason? Suppose if I take the patient within 6 hours or within few hours, 1 or 2 hours after the dialysis, what do I expect the patient to have?
The patient will be having signs of dehydration on induction. There is a risk of hypotension which can be resisted.
Hypovolemia is a problem. If I take after 24 hours,
there is a risk of fluid overload.
Hypervolemia. In this patient, do you think that his volume status is good? You have examined the patient? Or is he hypervolemic or hypovolemic?
He's normal volemic, sir. No signs of dehydration or volume overload in this patient, sir, at present.
So, what are the signs of volume overload in a patient who has got, end-stage renal disease?
There will be facial puffiness and generalized edema, bilateral pituitary edema. On clinical examination, there may be elevated JVP.
What you have written in the examination findings only, I was trying to tell you.
Okay.
You written puffiness of face is there, pedal edema is there.
Yes, sir.
When pedal edema is there, puffiness is there, definitely the patient has not been properly, volume load is still there. Okay. The patient still has a higher volume load. And what is the problem? Suppose if the patient has got an hypervolemia and you take him up for surgery, why you are so pertinent about this volume?
Increased
what can happen volume to the patient?
Further fluid administration during the surgery will exacerbate this, and that may resulting in pulmonary edema.
Is he prone for pulmonary edema as such, these patients with end-stage renal disease?
Yes, because these patients will be having a low albumin and their on-body pressures will be less, and also the patient's pulmonary vasculature will be more permeable, and also chronic kidney disease patients will be having sodium water retention and volume overload. So all three reasons are increased risk of pulmonary edema.
So you have to see that when the patient comes to you, he is almost dry, isn't it? So the dry weight, what do you mean by dry weight?
Dry weight is the lowest possible weight that the patient can tolerate without any intradialectical complication. It is the weight at which the patient is not overhydrated or dehydrated, and the patient is normotensive.
So you should always know by looking at the patient, facial puffiness, peripheral edema and crepitations. So these things should not be there. That means the patient has got now the dry weight. So because you have also weighed the patient. Okay, go to the next slide. Come to the next slide. So, here you have written all these things. Usually, majority of these patients will have ischemic heart disease, isn't it? Is it ischemic heart disease very common in end-stage renal disease patients?
Yeah, the risk is 10 times more than normal people.
What is the cause for ischemic heart disease?
It is accelerated atherosclerosis. It is mainly due to the decreased clearance of the triglycerides and the decreased lipoprotein activity, and hence decreased lipolysis that may cause accelerated atherosclerosis. And this patient have associated hypertension and a concentric NDH.
You have written apical impulse in the fifth intercostal space, and you are telling concentric hypertrophy of the left ventricle. Where is it? Isn't it? You have written in, I have gone through your examination. Isn't it? Where will be the apical impulse if the patient has got an hypertrophy of the left ventricle?
It should be shifted to left.
Yeah, shifted downwards and outwards. Isn't it? It will be in 6th intercostal space, 1 or 2 centimeters lateral to the midclavicular line. So that is ruled out because you have written that. I hope you have examined him properly. Anyway. Now, what is very important when you are talking about a patient with ischemic heart disease, what should be asked in the history? Because you have written that no chest pain. Okay, let us say that no chest pain. What other things you have to know, before accepting the patient, and whether you have to do any other cardiac, non-invasive cardiac testing to be done or not?
To assess the functional reserve or effort intolerance, we have to assess the patient. Using non-invasive stress test.
No. Meds you have to elicit, isn't it? In the history, see, that is missing in your history. What I am trying to tell you is, what are the things here it's missing in your history? So meds are very, very important. Why meds are important in this patient? Because he is being taken for a non-renal surgery, non-transplant surgery, isn't it? Why meds are very important? He is a known, he will be a known ischemic heart disease. He will have, definitely. Why meds?
Patient is having low value of meds, then there is a risk of cardiovascular major events in the intraoperative period. This patient is able to walk one flight of stairs, so his metabolic meds score is close to 4 to 5. So the there is a
major adverse cardiac event
during
less, the patient has got a higher meds, isn't it? Moderate, good or excellent meds. So that, you know, you have to bring in the history, what is his excess tolerance? And you, index of excess tolerance or physical capacity, you have to bring out. So that is missing. So what did you ask, any history of his excess tolerance?
He can do his own routine activities, and he can climb even a flight of stairs.
So he is a coolie.
That's the history he told.
He is a manual laborer, you have written.
Yes.
So is he continuing with his manual labor work?
Not right now. He's now he's hospitalized, not able to do work, not doing
this
work.
This is only for the past few days.
Yes.
Before,
after starting dialysis, he is not doing any heavier any job.
So it is very important to know what is his meds based on his occupation, whether he is able to continue his occupation. Now, what is the amount of walk he can do, climbing he can do, how many flights of stairs he can climb. So all these are very, very important, because the more the meds means, better reserve, will have less complications intraoperatively. That is one thing. Another thing you have also taken is seizures, memory loss, loss of sense. So why did you ask this particular history in it's a CKD patient?
Pathophysiological, CNS complications happening in CKD.
What CNS complications?
Patient can have central nervous system symptoms, peripheral nervous system symptoms, and autonomic nervous system symptoms. And the CNS, he can have loss of memory, seizures, asphyxis, uremic encephalopathy. He can also have in the peripheral nervous system, if it is at CKD stage 4, there is the bilateral distal mixed polyneuropathy, and also there is a risk of autonomic nervous system dysfunction, which can be elicited in the history by resting tachycardia, orthostatic hypotension, hypoglycemic unawareness.
He doesn't have any diabetes.
No, sir.
That is for hypoglycemic unawareness,
incontinence,
unresponsiveness, and all. So, what is dialysis disequilibrium?
This dialysis disequilibrium syndrome actually means it is a reverse urea effect. After starting dialysis, slowly the urea from the blood is eliminated. So there will be an osmotic gradient developed between the brain and the blood. That causes the shift of the fluid from the blood to the brain, that resulting in cerebral edema. It is usually manifested as headache, nausea, vomiting, visual disturbances, delirium like symptoms, and it usually settles down automatically.
Yeah, that usually after one or two dialysis, isn't it? Not after so many dialysis. Okay. Now, you know, urea is a problem here. Definitely, even otherwise, end-stage renal disease, uropathy is another problem. Okay, next, let us go to the next slide. So, okay, now this patient is on multiple drugs. Okay, tell me, Sultan, what kind of a drug is it, and what is the problem for you?
Angiotensin receptor blocker.
Okay.
Antihypertensive.
Okay. Now, if the patient is on telmisartan, it is an ARB drug. So, angiotensin receptor blocker. So, any investigations you have to do for this patient?
Potassium level I have to check, because it can cause hyperkalemia.
Yeah. How about end-stage renal disease? Does it also produce hyperkalemia?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So, in a patient already having hyperkalemia, is it advisable to give ARBs and AC inhibitors?
They are the drug of choice.
to slow the progression of the CKD AC inhibitor.
He is already in end stage renal disease, man. Where is the question of
reduce the intramedullary pressures and to reduce proteinuria?
No, ideally speaking, usually it is given when the patient is developing CKD, so that you can reduce the progression. End stage renal disease, actually, it can produce problems because of, again, the potassium levels can increase. So you have to get a serum potassium level done. In why ARB can produce increase in potassium?
The excretion of potassium is...
No, I'm not talking about ESRD. I'm talking about telmisartan. Why it can produce hyperkalemia? All AC inhibitors and ARBs can produce hyperkalemia. Why? This is very commonly asked question in the exam.
They will block the renin, angiotensin, aldosterone axis. The aldosterone is the function is that a sodium retention and potassium excretion. That axis is blocked very by good. This. That may resulting in hyperkalemia.
Yes, very good. So basically, by blocking the effect of aldosterone, so hyperkalemia can occur. So you should always be knowing. So another thing is, majority of the times, do we continue this drug on the day of surgery?
No, sir. Usually, we will stop AC inhibitors and ARBs 24 hours prior to surgery because it can cause exaggerated hypotension during induction. So
not only exaggerated, refractory hypotension can occur. But nowadays, it is not a hard and fast rule that you should always stop the drug. You can still continue, provided you have to be careful about, isn't it? Suppose why we call it as a refractory hypotension, which drug it will respond to? If the patient develops a refractory hypotension as a result of AC inhibitors or ARBs, what is the drug of choice? Which drug usually may be ideal as a vasopressor?
Phenylephrine.
Vasopressin. So many times it has been found that in many other books also it is written that it may respond only to vasopressin. Okay. The second drug, the patient is also on clonidine. Okay, clonidine is what sort of a drug?
It is an centrally acting alpha-2 agonist.
So do we continue on the day of surgery?
It can be continued.
Yeah, it will be continued. The third drug, patient is on sodium bicarbonate. Why? Why oral sodium bicarbonate?
Because this patient may have associated metabolic acidosis.
Why metabolic acidosis?
Because here the acid production is increased, but bicarbonate production absorption is decreased.
Acid production
the inability of the kidney to excrete the positive ions, the ammonium ions, will result and subsequent reduction in the bicarbonate ions in the blood will lead to metabolic acidosis.
Isn't it? So the patient will retain more of hydrogen ions, will not be able to excrete, and bicarb gets used up in the extracellular compartment to buffer the hydrogen ions. So bicarbonate levels will come down. So that is the reason the patient can have metabolic acidosis. What are the consequences of metabolic acidosis?
There will myocardial depression is one cause. Muscle weakness and muscle wasting. Reduction in insulin sensitivity, and then bone turnover is also increased. Musculoskeletal problems.
Yes, potassium.
Potassium level risk of hyperkalemia.
So it is very important to know that these patients will have metabolic acidosis, and if any problem with local anesthetic effect, then the patient has metabolic acidosis.
Yes, this is in the acidic environment, the local anesthetics won't act because as the media become more alkaline, the local anesthetic will easily penetrate and it has a sudden onset of action. But in acidosis, the onset of action is delayed.
Delayed because of the PKA.
PKA.
So, the PKA of lidocaine is 7.8 and bupivacaine is 8.1. 7.8 being close to 7.4, so onset of action is faster. But if the basic pH itself is reduced, the body pH, then PKA and the pH is away, so more of the drug will be in the ionized portion, so it cannot act. So this is also an effect of acidosis, common question in the exam, so you should always remember about. Okay, now another drug the patient is also is on is calcitriol. So what is the importance of this calcitriol?
To calcitriol is you mainly used to reduce the phosphate levels.
What is it actually? What is it?
Patient is
vitamin D3.
Why vitamin D3 is important to be given exogenously in this patient? Is he not able to synthesize?
Because if the patient will be having hyperphosphatemia because of the lack of ability of the kidneys to excrete phosphate, and subsequently the due to the kidney injuries or there is a reduction in production of active form of vitamin D3 by the kidney, which in turn results in the decreased absorption of calcium from the intestine. This will lead to secondary hyperparathyroidism, which will lead to increased bone resorption and osteitis, fibrosis, stica, and renal osteodystrophy. In order to prevent these consequences, we will give exogenously calcitriol.
Okay, you know that this patient may have renal osteodystrophy, isn't it? So how does it affect you as anesthesiologist?
If we are giving an epidural or spinal anesthesia, there is a risk of vertebral fractures in this patient, and also during positioning also there is a risk of fractures in this patient. So we have to be careful by positioning the patient and also during institution of regional anesthesia.
Okay, so these are very important, isn't it? So one more drug the patient is also on is erythropoietin. Why erythropoietin is being given to this patient?
Erythropoietin is given to improve the hemoglobin levels and also to improve the platelet dysfunction in this patient.
Why hemoglobin level you think that can be reduced and these patients can have severe anemia?
Because of the CKD itself, patients they have chronic anemia because the uremia can cause hemolysis, and during dialysis that itself can cause a hemolysis, and there will be renal because of the secondary hyperparathyroidism that may cause a bone marrow depression and bone marrow fibrosis. So RBC production will be decreased. That is another cause of anemia. And because of the kidney damage, erythropoietin production will be decreased. That is another cause of hemolysis. And sometimes due to the coagulation problems, the patient may have bleeding diathesis. As a result of this bleeding, anemia may occur. These are the major reason for
development. What happens to the lifespan of RBCs?
RBC lifespan is reduced and there is malnutrition.
Another cause. Okay, but this anemia is a acute anemia or a chronic anemia?
Chronic.
What are the, changes in the body that take place to manage this kind of anemia?
Because in anemia here, the 2-3 DPG diphosphoglycerate level in this patient is increased. So that will shift the oxygen dissociation curve to right. That increases the oxygen delivery to the peripheral tissue. Along with that, here it is acidosis, H plus concentration. That again shift the ODC to right. And it is the chronic anemia, the patient is in a high output state. So that will increase the microcirculation. That also increases the oxygen delivery. These are the compensatory mechanisms in CKD.
No, you did not talk about hyperdynamic circulation that occurs, increase in cardiac output, which is the most important thing. Now, why should you, because, in olden days, we never used to give any erythropoietin or anything because not available. So we used to take them up even at 6.5 or 7 grams of hemoglobin. Now, what is the hemoglobin usually achieved before surgery we have to accept these patients?
Target is 11 to 12 grams per deciliter.
Nowadays, why not about 12 grams?
Because it can cause thrombosis, hypertension, thrombosis of the AV fistula and other thromboembolic complications.
The exaggeration of hypertension can occur. So maximum is 11-12. So one more thing about the anemia is, the flow will be much higher with lower hematocrit. Why flow will be higher with low viscosity and low hematocrit? What law is usually used? Gas law? A fluid law, for example. Here it's a fluid. Have you heard about Hagen-Poiseuille's law?
Yes, sir.
Hagen-Poiseuille's law says that the flow is inversely proportional to the viscosity, isn't it? So that way, even a lower hematocrit will help in better perfusion of the tissue. So that's the another reason why. But for you, if the patient is anemic, what is the transfusion trigger in these patients? So for example, now the patient has to be taken up as an emergency. He has a cholecystitis. Suppose it is there is a rupture of the gallbladder. They have to take up as an emergency. you require his hemoglobin is 7 grams. Should you transfuse him before taking up or?
If it is less than seven grams per deciliter,
is for all other patients is transfusion trigger.
Or if the patient is symptomatic with hypertension and tachycardia,
we will transfuse.
Transfusion. We'll try to avoid transfusion in order to
Want to transfuse, what kind of packed cells you will be transfused?
Leukoreduced irradiated cytomegalovirus negative blood PRBCs.
Irradiated also.
Irradiated.
Isn't it? So yes. That is what, why you take so much of precautions?
To prevent the sensitization of the HLA antigen, because these patients are candidates for future transplant surgeries and to avoid graft rejection in these patients.
Yeah. Should the transplant surgery should be done first or this cholecystectomy should be done first for this patient, ideally speaking?
Ideally, it's better to do an early transplant than.
Early transplant will help elective, these patients?
Since it is an elective surgery, we can do it after transplant.
So why early transplantation is always better than prolonged hemodialysis?
Because the 5-year mortality in a patient having undergone transplant is 70%, and the mortality in a patient who is undergoing dialysis about 30%. So it is
very good. So early transplantation is always better, but somehow he is being taken up for cholecystectomy. Okay, can we go for the next slides? And I'll leave it to Dr. Meenakshi Sundaram in another 2-3 minutes. So go to the next slides. Okay, next slide. Okay. Now you'll have to, whenever you are taking a history of these patients with the chronic kidney disease or end-stage renal disease, cause has to be found. What is the cause for his end-stage renal disease? So what are the most common causes which can produce ESRD?
Diabetes mellitus, systemic hypertension, glomerular nephritis, autoimmune diseases like HIV, lupus nephritis, hereditary diseases like polycystic kidney disease and Alport syndrome, aging, obstructive uropathy, then
tubular interstitial.
Yeah, you forgot the most common second cause, hypertension.
It's already
told, sir. You said diabetes and then went in for glomerular.
Hypertension.
Yeah, hypertension is the second most common cause. Yes. So, okay. Now let us go to the next few of the slides. The examination, come to the examination. Okay, next slide. Next slide. So everything is fine, isn't it? Except you found the apical impulse in the fifth intercostal space and you did not find any crepitations in the lungs. That is another very important thing you should always look for. Orthostatic hypotension you should always look for when these patients are on multiple drugs, multiple antihypertensives. Why should you look for orthostatic hypotension as such? How it, you know, matters for you as an anesthesiologist?
Because if the patient having associated autonomic dysfunction and he's
Because, you know, antihypertensives can produce orthostatic hypotension by themselves, isn't it? Especially clonidine centrally acting can produce vasodilatation, sympathetic outflow is reduced. So, you know, it can produce orthostatic hypotension. Diuretics can produce, nitrates can produce, isn't it? Alpha methyl dopa centrally acting, another drug can produce. Why should you know about this?
There will be increased chance for exaggerated hypotension intraoperatively.
Yes.
So we are more worried about this.
Yes, because they can develop, because they behave like hypovolemics and, you know, they cannot manage any kind of drugs which can produce further vasodilatation, like your propofol or even tapentone or even regional anesthesia like spinal anesthesia can produce severe refractory hypotension. Okay, let us go to the, you know, next slides. Okay, next slide. Okay, this fifth intercostal space, it's a question. Okay. So, right. Sir, it is now yours.
Yes.
Investigations and anesthetic management.
Before that, I want to know, Dr. Shamrud, you are doing second year or final year?
I'm actually secondary DMB, sir, first year.
What about Dr. Ashita?
Me too, sir. I am secondary DNP candidate first year.
For since how many years you are doing the second year?
Close to
1 year.
1 year.
So it's because I see you are doing very well. You are doing very well.
Thank you.
Even, because it is very difficult to face Dr. Guruzad as examiner, but because he was liberal to you as both of your second years, but you have done very well, right? So now I am.
One thing I want to comment here: it is very difficult to face you, Ran. No, I don't want to scare them.
Now I will take you to the gunpoint. Now I will take you to the gunpoint because you have done very well. What is the rifle criteria?
Because this is the criteria used in acute kidney injury. Here the rifle R means risk. This based on the GFR criteria and urine output. R means risk. Here the GFR criteria is GFR is decreased.
No, you just expand. You need not go into the detail. R is risk. I means injury.
F means failure. L means loss. And E means end stage renal disease.
Right. The idea is now it is a end stage renal disease you have mentioned. Okay. Before that, I want to know, you said the patient is taking tablet telmisartan, tablet clonidine. This question is to specifically Dr. Ashita. The patient is taking telmisartan and clonidine. What is the route employed for these drugs?
Orally.
That's what I want to say. Your pronunciation may be orally, but far as orally means through ear. The orally, you are pronouncing it as orally. It is common in your area, but because the meaning changes, you have mentioned it in the presentation, the patient is taking oral medications. No, oral is entirely different. Okay. So now what is the investigation you want to do for this patient?
All basic investigations like complete blood ground, that means hemoglobin, to know the baseline value of hemoglobin and the patient having any anemia. And second is total count to rule out any infection, and platelet count to know the baseline value, and bleeding.
So if the total count is more like 15,000 WBC, what do you take up the case?
Before taking the patient, we have to rule out any infection in this patient.
So I am asking, total count is 15,000. Whether you are going to take up the case for surgery or not?
I will.
You will consult Dr. Samrud, is it? You are seeing him.
If it is an emergency surgery, take up.
As you have mentioned, we are talking about this patient only. Okay. Don't say if it is emergency. We are talking about this patient. You have examined. So, Sara has accepted all your findings except apical impulse in the fifth left intercostal space at the midclavicular line. So, now you are going to take up this case or not? The total count is 15,000. It is yes or no. The surgeon is going to ask you yes or no.
No, sir. We will start an antibiotic prior to surgery, and after that we will take the patient.
Oh, you will not buy. If the WBC is increased, you will not take a visit. Right? It is your decision.
We Fine. Have to do DC, differential leukocyte count, prior to that.
See, but already you have said you will not take up the case. Then why you are doing differential count? Okay, leave it. What are the other investigations you will do?
Platelet. To know the baseline value, and then renal function test.
So what is the platelet value you will take of the patient for surgery?
It is 3.5 lakhs.
Oh, so a patient with the end stage renal disease on dialysis, he will have a platelet count of 3.5 lakhs.
Our patient having 3.1 lakhs.
I am asking you, at what level you will take up the patient for surgery?
If it is more than one lakh, platelet count is more than 1 lakh, you can take up the surgery. Or if the platelet count is more than 80,000, we can also institute regional anesthesia.
Then, go ahead.
50,000 is the cutoff value for surgical incision.
See, now you have come down from 3.5 to 0.5. What is this? You have started with 3.5, now you are coming down and say up to 0.5 lakhs, you will take up the case. Fine, proceed. Next, investigation.
renal function test, blood urea nitrogen, serum creatinine levels, electrolytes, serum sodium.
So these are all the tests when we will do after this dialysis. You will do all these tests, or even before that.
Before dialysis, we'll check the and also the morning of surgery. Also, we will ask for these investigations.
All right. So, see, somebody has asked in the chat box. So you please elaborate on dry weight. So you say, what is dry weight?
Dry weight is the lowest possible weight that the patient can tolerate without any intradialytical complication. This means the patient will not be having any symptoms of fluid overload or won't have any signs of dehydration, and the patient will also be normotensive.
So that is for that man. Right? What are the other investigations you will do?
Then I will do the coagulation study, PTNR, APTT, then chest X-ray to rule out if the patient is having any pleural effusions or any signs of infection like pneumonia, and then ECG to rule out any
ischemic changes,
arrhythmias due to hyperkalemia, or left ventricular hypertrophy, and then
we'll do an ABG
to rule out
acidosis,
and if and a 2D echo to understand the
2D echo to assess the left ventricular functional ejection fraction.
Right, you will even convince or confuse the examiner. So you are even elaborating on that, but you have missed one important test. I don't know whether it is included under ABG, but anyway, you have to separately mention that in renal failure, serum electrolytes.
Sir, already told, sir.
When?
Sodium, potassium, magnesium, calcium, and phosphorus.
So at what level of potassium you will take the case for surgery?
5.5.
So you are 5, he is 6, so average is 5.5, is it?
No, if it is less than 5.5,
we can take the patient for surgery.
Fine. So after dialysis, it will be less than 5.5 or more than 5.5?
It will be less than 5.5.
How will you treat hyperkalemia?
Can manage it based on the action, because the hyperkalemia can cause arrhythmia. So
I'm asking you, how will you manage hyperkalemia? Okay. I'm not asking about the side effects or effects of hyperkalemia.
Okay, sir. I will give IV calcium gluconate 10 ml 10% over 10 minutes. And
Why calcium gluconate?
Because the calcium can decrease the
membrane stabilizing action to prevent the
next.
Then regular insulin 10 units in 50 ml, 50% dextrose can be given. Then sodium bicarbonate 1 milliequivalent per kg can be given. Then nebulization with the beta 2 agonist like albuterol 2.5 mg can be given. Then potassium binding resins can be given. And injection furosemide 10 to 20 mg IV can be given. And ultimately dialysis.
Fine, right. What premedication you will give for this patient? What is your anesthesia of choice before that? For this patient, what is your anesthesia of choice?
Plan of anesthesia is a laparoscopic cholecystectomy. So our plan of anesthesia is general anesthesia with controlled ventilation.
Controlled ventilation. Oh, right. Tell me. Okay. So, what premedication you will give?
Premedication, day before surgery itself, we will give TAB metoclopramide 10 mg and TAB ranitidine 150 mg and an anxiolytic TAB alprazolam 0.5 mg on the day before surgery.
So what is the root? What is the root of all these tablets?
Orally.
I want you to practice that.
Okay. Okay.
Tell me.
On the day of surgery morning, we will give IV ranitidine 50 milligram IV, IV metoclopramide 10 mg and midazolam, injection midazolam 1 mg.
You want to give only ranitidine, not pantoprazole?
Either ranitidine or pantoprazole, sir.
What you want to give?
I will give ranitidine.
Ranitidine. Right. Proceed. Then?
And 1 mg midazolam. Injection midazolam 1 mg IV can be given.
That when you will give this midazolam? Morning you will give ranitidine, metoclopramide. When you will give this midazolam?
All the injections are given in the preoperative room, sir. Under guidance only I will give this.
No, no. I am asking you what is the time, whether it is 30 minutes.
Just half an hour prior to surgery.
Midazolam IV or IM?
IV.
IV. So, in which hand the cannula is present in your patient?
Left forearm.
No, IV is placed in the left forearm. Cannula is in the right arm.
Oh, IV can.
What you see already, where is this AV fistula is made?
Left AV fistula. So,
where your IV cannula will be there?
No, sir. We have IV AV fistula on the left hand. So, we will put cannula on the right hand.
That's what I asked you, but you said it is left. So, what I am saying, if you say right, it is right. If you say left, it is wrong. Tell me. 1 mg midazolam given, then?
Then, in the operating theater, I will give injection fentanyl, 100 microgram per.
So, you have non-operating theater also. Huh? Operating theater means you have non-operating theater also. In the operating theater. In the theater, tell me.
In the theater, I will give injection fentanyl, 100 microgram as a pre-medication.
What is the weight of your patient?
47 kg.
Right.
I will give 2 microgram per kg, approximately 100 microgram I will give. Then after pre-oxygenation, I will attach the non-invasive monitors, electrocardiogram, NIBP, pulse oximetry, and I will start induction after properly. I will give pre-oxygenation after that.
Sir, how many minutes you will give pre-oxygenation?
3 to 5 minutes with 100%
oxygen. What is the idea of giving this pre-oxygenation?
In order to increase the reserve of oxygen during intubation.
Denitrogenation.
Denitrogenation of the alveoli.
Right. Then?
Then I will induce after pre-oxygenating patient for about
Only one should anesthetize the patient. That is always better. So who not anesthetize? You want anesthetize, right? Tell me.
I will start induction with the titrated doses of propofol.
Minute. I could not understand what is the titrated dose of propofol.
Actually, this I will give slowly. I will give propofol very slowly according to the patient response, and I will always take the hemodynamic.
I could not understand. What is the patient response? What is the slowly? I could not understand exactly, because every time people say in the examination they will give titrated dose. I want to know what is titrated dose. Or how will you inject? You tell me. You prefer propofol. You can take his help also now, assistant, Dr. Samruj. What you are going to do? You have selected propofol, not thiopentone.
Not thiopentone.
Why not thiopentone?
Because it is having protein binding, extensive protein binding, so the levels are low in CKD patients.
What levels are low in CKD patients?
Albumin levels are low.
Yes, it is bound with albumin. So,
free fraction of the drug is more.
Free fraction is more. Right, that's right. So, thiopentone is alkaline or acidic?
Alkaline.
So, what will happen to the ionization?
Yes.
Sir asked about lignogen and PGA.
Okay, sir.
So, what happens in same thing applicable for thiopentone?
Ionization is less in alkaline.
When ionization is less, unionized fraction will have a profound action and a duration of action will also be more. So, right, you have selected propofol. How you are going to give propofol? How much propofol you are going to give?
I will give 1.5 mg per kg.
Propofol. No, I am not a mathematician. Ramanujam, to calculate all your doses. You tell me what is the dose? Why should I calculate?
Sorry, sir. My patient weight is 47 kg. I will give 70 to 80 mg propofol slowly for induction.
How much you will give?
70 to 80 mg propofol slowly. I will give. And I will confirm the ventilation after giving the induction dose.
No, whether 80 milligram of propofol is enough for this patient?
Just before intubation, I will give an additional dose of propofol.
What is this? I could not understand what you are telling. You are given fentanyl. Now you are giving propofol. Now you are giving propofol. We are stuck with that. How much propofol you will give?
80.
So you want to stand on 80. So the dose of propofol, you think it is less than 2 milligram per kg. Okay. What is the end point for propofol? How we will assess propofol has acted?
Patient will not be obeying the command. If he asks the patient to open the eyes,
any patient anesthetized, they will not obey your commands. Is it the way? What is the end point for thiopental?
We look for eyelash reflex.
So what is the end point for propofol?
Where?
But Sudarshan, Dr. Sudarshan has answered in the chat box. Whether you could see the chat box or not, he is giving you the clue. Loss of verbal response. You have to communicate with the patient. Okay? So the loss of verbal response, say, that is the difference between thiopental and propofol. Right? You have given propofol then?
And then I will check for the ventilation. If I can easily ventilate.
But you will check for the ventilation means what?
When I am giving a intermittent positive pressure ventilation, if the chest is rising,
why you are doing that?
Because the patient is now the respiration is shallow and the respiratory arrest occurs after induction. So I have to ventilate during this period. So I will give intermittent positive pressure ventilation with 100% oxygen.
So you expect some obstructed breathing may be there or there may be some difficulty in ventilation. Is it that? It is your point, is it?
Yes, sir.
But you have examined everything. You have said the thyromental distance, temporomandibular joint distance, this much, that much. Then why you are doing all these things? So you have checked. Then what you will do?
Then I will give atracurium at 25 mg for this patient as for intubation. I will
25 milligram for this patient.
Then I will wait for 3 minutes. And after that, I will give direct laryngoscopy and
I'll repeat. You will give fentanyl. You will give the propofol. You will give atracurium.
Okay, sir.
Then you will wait for 3 minutes. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
And then the patient will be dead. After giving atracurium, if you wait for 3 minutes, what will happen?
The patient will have sufficient muscle relaxation to do a scopy and intubation.
No. I'm asking if you give propofol and atracurium, and if you wait for 3 minutes, the patient will be dead.
During this period, we will be ventilating the patient.
That you have not mentioned. See, how come I know whether you will ventilate or not? You have not mentioned.
Sorry, sir.
You have to do that. No, sorry means you cannot tell the patient, sorry, he has already gone to heaven. Tell me.
We will do ventilation till 3 minutes. After 3 minutes, I will do a direct laryngoscopy and intubation with a cupped oral endotracheal tube of size 8 millimeters. And after checking the airway, I will fix
right. Now the blood pressure is 210 bar 140. What is your action?
I will decrease the BP by giving a bolus dose of propofol.
Mm-hmm.
20 mg.
So you will not do anything. You will not do anything to inhibit this pressure response before this.
Okay. You cannot do it now.
You have already done everything. See, the patient is a hypertensive patient. But you are not bothered. So then you have to manage now. 210, 140. You will use propofol. How much you will use?
20 to 30 mg.
So now what will BP has become normal, is it? Right. Then how will you proceed?
I will, after checking the air entry, fix the tube, and I will maintain the anesthesia with oxygen, air, and isoflurane.
Why not nitrous oxide?
This is a case of laparoscopic cholecystectomy. So it is better to avoid nitrous oxide because.
So which hospital you are working? You are doing your residency?
Baby Memorial Hospital, Calicut.
Which bile suppressors you are having? Then you have not gone to the theater. See, very simple question I am asking, because you may be imagining hyperkalemia, arrhythmia, atrial fibrillation, extrasystole.
Dragger.
See, you don't know how to convince the examiner also. If you say whatever, see, I cannot verify. I know if you are saying something wrong about scholine or propofol, I understand. If, see, just like that, you would have mentioned the name of a machine. But the pity is you don't even know the name of the machine.
Dragger machine.
So Dragger machine, what is the model? Dragger, what is the model? How many rotameters your Dragger machine has?
Three.
Three for air, oxygen and nitrous.
No, I am asking simple question. How many rotameters your machine has? Dr. Gurudat sir has taken 1.5 hours about bile suppressors. He has even discussed about a Dragger. Sorry. Don't know, sir. My idea of asking this question is whether you are regularly using the hospital for all laparoscopic procedures. Again, it is yes or no? Yes or no?
Sir, we are regularly using air oxygen mixture for laparoscopic procedure.
You could have informed me what is the machine you have, how many rotameters it has.
Six.
What is the color of the cylinder, air cylinder? Dr. Gurudutta sir, you take another class for them.
Yeah.
they
were not there probably on that day.
No. These people, even I asked her, Dr. Rashita, have you attended our session on translucency? It was on duty. So they are not even ready to check it in on the YouTube also. Then they say, we are doing second year, sir. They are saying, thinking they will become more brilliant. It is all the same. So I think people are wise, they are others. Anyway, right. So what are the monitors you will do? Because we are running short of time. What are all the monitoring you do?
After intubation, and then I will insert a temperature monitoring orally is inserted. And also I'll check the cuff pressure and maintain it between 20 to 30 centimeters.
I'm asking what are all the monitoring you will perform in the perioperative period.
Paraoperative period, ECG.
Heart rate, non-invasive BP, saturation, SpO2, and end-tidal carbon dioxide, and temperature, urine output. And
so, before that, I want to ask you, what is the color of oxygen cylinder?
Black body with white shoulder.
Thank God, you have saved me. Sir was very happy. At least you could answer what is the color of oxygen cylinder. That is wonderful. So what is the urine output you want to maintain during the perioperative period?
0.5 ml per kg per hour.
So if that 1 hour, during that particular 1 hour, if it is less than 0.5 ml per kg per minute, what do you want to do?
I will give a fluid bolus of 100 to 200 ml over 10 minutes, and if it is not improving, I will give a small dose of vasopressor. Inotrope.
Small means how small? Small dose. So how will you give that small dose? See, I'm asking a practical question. These are all the things you are going to face while managing the case.
Injection.
Furosemide 10 to 20 mg.
IV can be given.
Intravenous.
Furosemide 10 to 20 milligram. Then what are all the other drugs? What are all the other? 10 to 12 is a mosquito dose, right? What are the other drugs you can use?
Osmotic diuretics like mannitol can be given.
Fine.
10 to 20 gram IV. Then
what about this dopamine?
Dopamine. Okay, sir. Now dopamine analog phenyldopamine is used.
So what is the dose of dopamine? It is controversial only. I don't say that it will improve the urine output or anything. But what is the derivative of dopamine which acts only on DA1 receptors?
2 to 20 microgram per kg per minute.
No, I'm asking. Dopamine produces problems because it acts on dopamine 1 receptor, dopamine 2 receptor, alpha receptor, beta receptor, all receptors it acts. But one derivative of dopamine acts only on dopamine 1 receptors. What is the drug?
Phenyldopamine.
So it produces less tachycardia. It produces less tachycardia and good renal vasodilatation. It is proven, but anyway, I have not had any personal experience. So in the poor, how will you reverse the patient?
Using anticholinesterase neostigmine 2.5 mg and glycopyrrolate 0.4 mg.
What is the dose of neostigmine?
0.05 mg per kg.
So, which acts for more duration in renal failure patients? Atragurium or this neostigmine? Which acts for a longer time?
Neostigmine.
Yes, neostigmine. So, if the residual cunarization occurs, it is not due to the muscle relaxants. It may be due to some interaction between the antibiotics or other drugs. So, you should know what are the nephrotoxic drugs. So, what is the postoperative analgesic you want to give?
We'll give injection paracetamol 1 gram IV and fentanyl infusion. Fentanyl, and we can give tablet.
Paracetamol 1 gram IV for every 2 hours, every 3 hours,
every eight hours.
So fentanyl, and in addition to that, you want to give fentanyl.
If patient again complaining of any pain, I will give bolus dose of fentanyl with adequate.
What is the dose?
20 to 25
microgram. So you will visual and score, and again you will top up. 25. What is the dose of fentanyl?
1 to 2.
Why for a 47 kg patient you are giving 25 gram of fentanyl? See, you know the dose of fentanyl, then why you want to reduce that dose?
Because there will be chance of respiratory depression in the postoperative if we are giving a high dose of fentanyl.
What is high dose? What is the normal dose of fentanyl, I'm asking?
1 to 2 mics per kg.
Yes.
One to two
your patient weighs 47 kg, am I right?
Yes, sir.
So what is the dose? Even if it is 1 microgram, it comes to 47 microgram.
Okay, sir.
But it is 25. See, you can say anything, but you should substate. So, the white diclofenac injection can be given. Diclofenac injection for post-op analgesia.
And the NSAIDs can further worsen the renal injury. So better to avoid that because it is a prostaglandin inhibitor. The prostaglandins are responsible for the increased vasodilatation of renal blood flow. That is inhibited.
So, what is the difference between the effects of NSAID and ARB as far as this glomerular apparatus is concerned? NSAID acts in one area and ARB acts on the other area. As far as
the NSAID will act on the afferent arterioles, and the ARB will act on the efferent arterioles.
Excellent, excellent. So what I am inferring, you are reading very well, but your practical exposure is less. So my question comes, how many lab cholecystectomy you have done so far in your institution?
Sir, weekly we will have eight to nine cases.
Why, that man is not accepting that?
No, yes, sir.
Yes,
my sir. Is not accepting that. Huh?
Actually, his thesis is about lab cholecystectomy.
So that is the problem. So if the patient in the post-operative period, if the patient complains of froth in the mouth and the heart rate is 120, BP is 180, 110, how will you manage?
That is a case of pulmonary edema. So I will give 100% oxygen and...
See, as an anesthesiologist, if you say oxygen, oxygen is a drug. You have to say what is the root you will give, for how many hours you will give, everything you have to say. If you say 100% oxygen, whether it is a nasal oxygen or a mask oxygen or a CPAP, BiPAP, invasive ventilation, how come I know?
100% oxygen, I will give 100% oxygen and bag and mask ventilation. If the saturation is maintained, I will...
A small doses of dose of morphine. What
is small dose? Again,
3 mg of, 3 to 5 mg of morphine I will give. And
hey, boss, you can give either 3 milligram or 5 milligram. You cannot give 3 to 5 milligram. How
three
much
milligram.
You will give? Why you are giving morphine? Why you are giving morphine?
Due to the vasodilating effect of morphine. So
vasodilatation. What vasodilatation?
Coronary
vasodilatation. Why you are using it for pulmonary edema?
Sir, we will give loop diuretics.
No, morphine. First of all, you finish morphine, then we will go to other drug. Morphine.
I will give oxygenation with 100% oxygen, and I will give loop diuretics, IV furosemide, 40 to 60 mg IV, and check
again,
for the...
Again, you cannot say 40 to 60 mg. You say 1 mg.
60 mg.
Anyway, right, proceed.
And I will check the BP in between. If it is... if the saturation, oxygenation is not maintained, I will intubate the patient and control the ventilation with 100%.
If you are talking about any saturation, if the saturation is maintained, you will intubate, is it? If the saturation is not maintained, you will intubate. That's all.
And if...
I think if the positive pressure relationship again, in the post-operative period, you want to intubate. How will you intubate? What drugs you will use, I am asking.
Okay. We can give Ectomidate.
Oh, Ectomidate. Very good. Ectomidate. That's what I am writing. Ectomidate is highly nephrotoxic. Etomidate, I have never seen in practice. Etomidate is nephrotoxic also. Then how to etomidate? I have not seen etomidate. Whether you have seen etomidate, then I will ask you, what is the dose of etomidate?
0.3 to 0.6.
How it is excreted?
Renal
is
excretion.
So renal excretion, how you can use for this patient? So if you are using, Dr. Ashita, if you are using etomidate, you could have used it in the paraoperative period itself. Why in the paraoperative period it is propofol, postoperative period etomidate, then paraoperative fentanyl, postoperative alfentanyl. What is this? Whatever drugs you know, you are telling. Anyway, I think we have reached our time. So finish off in time. So, but definitely you have done well. Definitely you have done well. Just because you have done the first portion very well, that is a trailer. In the main movie, it was diverting you here and there. But for the second year, you have done very well. And I am sure that both of you will pass your examination if you appear jointly. That is, you have to appear together. One is missing, one is adding another point. So you are appearing alone, I don't know. All the best. Thanks, ISA, for the opportunity.
Thank you, sir.
Intra, precautions to be taken for lap cholecystectomy for a end-stage renal disease patient.
For in order to prevent kidney injury, we have to adequate volume loading should be done prior
to. When it comes to the, you know, when they use
pneumoperitoneum to reduce the, we should keep the intra-abdominal pressure less than 15 millimeters of mercury. We should restrict the duration of pneumoperitoneum while we are placing the patient in head-up position in laparoscopic cholecystectomy. The position and change should be done very slowly. And also we should, overall timing of the laparoscopy and pneumoperitoneum should be reduced because pneumoperitoneum will reduce the renal blood flow by about 35 to 60%, but and cause irreversible oliguria in patients. But with significant kidney diseases, these effects will be accentuated.
Okay, that is one thing. And then intraop fluid therapy in these patients.
Since the patient
is a ESRD patient, you can't go with the urine output, isn't it? Because there won't be urine output. So what method of intraop fluid management you'll be doing, going in for? Because any extra fluid, you'll go for pulmonary edema because you only said that he's highly prone for pulmonary edema. What fluids and how much fluid?
Usually, crystalloids like a renal lactate we can give for IV fluid therapy, or balanced salt solution like a plasma light also can be given.
But both of them will contain potassium.
And the initial potassium value is, if it is less than, for this patient is near 4.1. So
we can accept. And
like here, you know, one thing you should always realize for lap cholecystectomy, they don't require much fluids, isn't it?
Yes.
So already he is on a restricted fluid management. He would not be, even on the urologist would have advised, sorry, nephrologist would have been advised these patients not to take much of even oral intake also. You have to be extremely careful. You don't give too much of fluid. You have to really restrict your fluid. So probably you can give maximum about 100 to 200 ml maximum, that is, you know, not more than 300 to 400 ml in these patients throughout the whole surgery. That is one thing, precaution you have to take. Second thing is, are they prone for thromboembolic problem also? Increased thrombogenicity is there in these patients?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Increased thrombogenicity, DVT chances are very high.
Very high. So
in this position, head up position, what happens to the blood in the lower half of the body?
Yes, venous pooling of blood. There is also reduced venous return.
So how do you prevent, DVT and thromboembolism?
Fast compression stockings can be applied intraoperatively in order to prevent the DVT. And we can give enoxaparin prophylaxis postoperatively.
So these are very, very important, isn't it? So because, this patient is posted for lap cholecystectomy, I just wanted to add this. So most of the things have been extensively discussed by Dr. Meenakshi Sundaram intraoperatively and postoperatively. So, sir, thank you very much. Thanks for
thank you.
They did very well. And thanks for ISA Kerala for all these opportunities.